हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग माँ।
होप यू आर ऑल प्रैक्टिस ऑल द क्लासेस कॉन्सेप्ट क्लासेस हाउ टू क्रिएट ऑब्जेक्ट एंड हाउ टू कम्युनिकेट एंड प्रैक्टिस दिस कीवर्ड कंस्ट्रक्टर्स डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्टर्स मेथड राइटिंग पैरामीटर पासिंग ओके स्टैटिक कीवर्ड। सो ऑल द थिंग्स आर वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। यू मस्ट प्रैक्टिस एंड यूज द एक्सरसाइजेस गिवन हियर। You can practice those also. For example, for classes and objects, let us say there are some exercises given. Okay, so those by exercise problems you can do. Right. So let us see. Here an example is given. Create a class box. Let us understand how to write this. Create a class box that uses a
parameterized constructor to initialize the dimensions of a box. I already told you that constructor, what is the purpose of a constructor? Constructor is used to initialize the object. For example, here the class box. Okay, so we can create a class box and we can have a constructor which is a parameterized constructor. So that parameterized constructor is useful to initialize the dimensions of the box. Dimensions of the box are width, height and depth. Okay, so first of all, this is the first part. So you should have a class. Inside that there are there is a parameterized constructor. That parameterized constructor should initialize all the things. And another class, the class should have a method, and the same class, the class should have a method that return the volume of the box. So within the class box, you have to maintain a method called volume method. Volume method, that volume method need to return the volume of the box. So this is the box class. So next, create an object of box class and test the functionalities. So this is what the program is. Let me show you one example so that you will practice. I have already shown you the examples. This example also I explain you with the help of the Eclipse environment.
So everybody can use this Eclipse environment. I will demonstrate to you. So now I shall tell you some simple things you can use. Later in a session, I will take a session for explaining the functionality and the usage of this Eclipse environment. Eclipse is open source. You can download freely from the internet. The demo. So now you see, I have created a class. So initially, the class asked in the question, that is box class. You can see the question, box class. See the question, create a class box that uses a parameterized constructor to initialize the dimensions of a box. So dimensions are given, width, height and depth. Okay, so let me define, let us say double width, depth and height. You can define within the single statement or you can define individually also, that is your wish. So now what is the purpose of a constructor? The constructor is a parameterized constructor. Actually, we have to write this constructor with the parameters. It is better you can use different names like this, or if you want to use the this keyword, then you can use the same names also. That is your wish. Okay. So here I can. So what is the purpose of this parameterized constructor?
Use this parameterized constructor to initialize the dimensions of the box. Okay. So width is assigned by W.
Depth is assigned by D. Similarly, width is assigned by. Double H. So width is initialized by H. So this is what the parameterized constructor in the program asks. Okay, I can generate this constructor in this Eclipse. That is the benefit. I remove this. I show you how to create it automatically. Okay, source. Go to source. Later I tell you. No problem. Just using this. Generate constructor using fields. I want all the constructors, all the fields. So I have created the constructor automatically. So I need not do it separately. Okay, this is the asked in the program, parameterized constructor. So you can see same double width, depth, height are taken here also. That is why this keyword is used in order to distinguish the local variable and instance variable. So this refers the instance variable. Okay. So in the program, it asked another thing, that is what it asked, volume. So volume of the box we have to return. So take a name, volume. Okay, you need not have any arguments, because you can directly use the instance variable anywhere. So return what it asked, volume. So how to define the volume? Volume can be defined as width into depth into height. Okay, so our portion is completed. So whatever the box class asked in the program is completed now. Now class is ready. Now what is our duty? We have to create some object and we see the functionality. So this is the another class, public class B demo we have created, which contains the main method. So here we create an object for class box. Okay, box B, U, box, and now you have to understand the use of constructors. So whatever the constructor we have taken for the box is a parameterized constructor. So same thing we have to write here, box here. Whatever the values are required for the parameterized box constructor, so those values you have to pass supply from here. Let us say 14.2, 36.5. Let us say 24.8. These are the three values I am passing to the parameterized constructor box to initialize the depth, height, and width. Okay. So now, so what is the method? It has volume method. If you want to get the volume, what you have to do? You have to invoke it. So it's the method is returning something. Either you can keep it in some variable. Let us say wall. Like this, you can keep the volume B dot volume. You can write like this, or you can, if you want to print it directly, you can print it in the print statement. So system dot out dot println box volume is wall. Okay,
so see the program, go through the program again. So box class asked in the program, we have defined the box class. However, it is mentioned there, parameterized constructor and volume method to return the volume. So now we have created an object here with the help of this statement. And next, we printed the, displayed the volume. Let us see how it works.
Errors, not this program, some other program. So this is what box volume is. Box volume is 12,853.84.
This is the box volume. Okay. So in this program, I would like to remember you. I would like to mention you another point which we are already gone through. And a class can have any number of objects, sir. Why I am repeating is most important. People may confuse while they are practicing. You need not confuse anywhere. Okay. Again, I tell you. You see, you have created one box parameter. Let us say B1, for example. Now let us say B2 is the another one. Here we change the values 25.4, 36.8, 11.6, for example. So here the name is Wall1. Okay. Here it is B1. Here it is B2. Okay. Wall1. Okay, volume box 1, volume box 2, volume, like that we write. Box 1 volume, box 2 volume, save it. Now you check how many boxes are created now, 2 boxes. So 2 different volumes will be displayed. That is, first one is the box 1 volume, second one is box 2 volume. Why I am showing this example is, you have to understand, you can create as many objects you want. So each individual object is different. So that is why I am just mentioning you. And you can also check whether boxes, whether the objects are same or different. Okay, by just displaying its hash code. Okay. So now, and another program is also given. You try on your own, sir. So the another program is create a new class called calculator. So it is a very simple program. It with the following methods: power int, power double, power int and power double, two methods. Power int is one method which is having number 1 and number 2 are the two parameters. Static method, which is a static method. You please remember, whenever you use the static numbers or static methods, if you want to provide access of the static method somewhere, that also should be another static member, because a static member can be
accessed by another static member only.
And I think now you can practice this on your own. Okay. So create a class and do it. Now let us go for inheritance part. I have covered all the things there. Now we go for inheritance part. So can anybody tell me what is inheritance? Inheritance is nothing but acquiring the properties of a base class by its children. Okay, now I have to tell you again, whatever the class, because one should understand the hierarchy part. Whatever the class you create first, that is the base class. For example, if you have created a class A initially, so that is the base class. Okay. So inheritance is nothing but acquiring the properties. Properties means anything. Properties of base class by its children means what? Suppose if class A is contained, for example, XY2 variable. Similarly, there is a method show, for example. Okay, there are two variables and a method. If there is a class B as well as C, B and C are the child classes of class A.
Whatever the class you first defined, that is called base class. Whatever the classes which are derived from class A, base class, are called child classes. So in Java, we have to use a keyword called extends keyword. if you want to define a class, that is a child class of some parent class, you have to write like this: class B extends A, means whatever the properties are there in A, base class will be extended to its child class also. So if I want to make the child B to A, so I have to write class B extends A. Class B extends A means whatever the properties are contained by class A are extended to B also. Similarly, if I write simply class B, there is no meaning. There is no meaning. I just show you. For example, class A. For example, class A. So I am thinking this is the base class. For example, it contains x comma y. For example, x comma y. Okay, x is let us say 10. Y is let us say 27. Okay, so void show, for example, void show is a method of this base class. Base class is the parent class which has no parent in general. Okay, base class is the class which is created first. So for example, system dot out dot println hello, I am base class. Okay, this is some method. So now if you want to create another class, class B, suppose you have created class B. Now is there any relationship with A and B? No, there is no relationship with A with B. So how do I associate A with B? Means simply I have to use a keyword called extends keyword. I have to then write the class name from which this new class is deriving. That is why the child class is also called a derived class, because it is deriving from a particular parent class. Means indirectly it is also able to acquire the properties which are already there in A. Means if you want to use some particular property, unless it is private, remember, if there is a property in base class means parent class, unless the property is private, except private member, any other property can be reused or directly accessed or used from its child classes. How? Without redefining them. Suppose if I want to use, for example, show method, I need not redefine show. Directly I can ask show to execute here. Okay, so that is what inheritance is. So let us go through what are the forms of inheritances, then we go for the actual functionality. Okay,
inheritance. So okay, I tell you here, there are some level only. So the inheritances are, there is a single inheritance means there is only one parent class with one child class. Let us say A and B. A is parent, B is child. Single inheritance, there is only one parent class and one child class. There is hierarchical inheritance. Hierarchical inheritance, and there is multi-level inheritance. There is one more concept called hybrid inheritance. There is one more term called multiple inheritance, which is not existed in Java. Inheritance, multiple inheritance does not allowed in Java directly, does not supports by Java, but it is indirectly accessing. It indirectly supports it. Multiple inheritance means there are multiple parent, for example class A and class B are there. These are the two parent classes, for example. Okay, and let us say class B is a child class which extends from, let us say, if I want to define let us say some class X extends A comma B. Can I write it like this, sir? No, it is impossible. It is impossible in Java with the help of classes, which leads to multiple inheritance. It is absolutely wrong. It is wrong. Okay, so hierarchical and multiple inheritance are nothing but, so let us say A is the parent, B is the child of A, and C is the child of B, for example. This is multi-level. Hierarchical means A can have more than one child, means B comma C can be child of A, B and C can be children of A.
Okay, that is possible. A parent class, there can be any number of child classes, that is possible. And another level is, one A is the parent of B, B is the parent of C, B is the child of A, C is the child of B. That is possible. That is possible. So single inheritance is possible. There is only one parent class and one child class. That is possible. But multiple inheritance concept is not supporting by Java strongly, directly, because there is a concept called multiple inheritance. Means, I'll show you one by one example. See, this is class A, for example. Class B extends A. This is correct. This is single inheritance. This is right. One parent class is there, one child class is there. Suppose if you want to have another class, for example, class C extends A. This is also correct, because there are two child classes for a single parent class. Class A is the base class. Class B and C are the children of A. This is also correct. Okay. This is hierarchical. Now let us see multi-level. Multi-level means this is hierarchical.
This is hierarchical. Hierarchical inheritance. In hierarchical inheritance, one parent can have any number of children. Suppose if you see, multi-level inheritance. Multi-level inheritance means different levels of parents. For example, class A, side by side I'm just writing because this space is common. So class A, class B extends what? A. So now class B becomes the children of class A. I'll show you this example just for the understanding purpose. I'm telling you. Class C extends what? Class C extends A or B. If it is A, it is hierarchical. If it is B, now you can understand it is multi-level. A is the parent of B. B is the parent of C. So the parent-child relationship is existed like that. Grandfather, father, and son. So it is a multi-level. Hierarchical means, so a parent can have multiple children. That is a hierarchical. And you see, one more I told you that is not existed in Java. If you can't write like this, multiple inheritance. Multiple inheritance. But this is practically we can implement through, indirectly we can implement through a concept called interfaces. I tell you there, I explain you there. With the help of interfaces concept, we can implement this particular multiple inheritance. For example, class A is there. Suppose I want to define class B is there. Two independent classes. There is no relationship between A and B. Now I want to define another class. For example, side here I am writing class C. For example, extends A comma B. That is impossible in Java. This is not possible in Java. A single class cannot be extended from multiple classes. That is what multiple inheritance. So multiple inheritance is not applicable in Java directly, but indirectly it is possible. Indirectly it is possible with the help of interfaces. The help of interfaces it is possible. Okay. So there are some terminology. The terminology you have to understand actually is a generic terminology. Inheritance. Using inheritance, you can create a general class at the top. That is the base class. This class may then be inherited by other more specific classes, means one or more classes. That is your specific. The class does the inheritance is referred to the subclass, means the class which is created from a base class is a subclass. The main importance of inheritance is the subclasses can utilize or acquire or reuse whatever the term you call. The if anybody asks you what is the benefit of inheritance, what is the need of inheritance, you can answer reusability. Inheritance is a reusable component, means if some property is existed in parent class, the property need to access by the child class can directly access it. It need not redefine it directly. It can access. That is called inheriting. Inheritance means simply acquiring, simply reusing the property. Okay, the subclass inherits all the properties of its superclass. So this is a relationship. For example, four employees of a department and their manager has a relationship with this is container ship. Okay, so all these you can see this is an example how we have to single inheritance model. So a single inheritance, just I tell you, a subclass can inherit from a superclass, means there is only one parent class and one child class. So after defining the parent class, the inheritance, if you want to provide inheritance, how do you write? So class, whatever the name you choose for your derived class, and extends keyword. This extends keyword, what is the purpose of extends keyword? The extends keyword, using the property extends keyword, the whatever the parent class properties are there, the parent class properties will be extended to subclass also. So here the base class name you have to write. Suppose derived class name is B, base class name is A, you have to write class B extends A. Let us see an example for this. You see this example. Here class A is there. This is the super class, and two variables M comma N, and display one is a method. M and N are here, the values are displaying here. So now there is a subclass is class B. Class B extends A, because A is the super class, base class. So now class B is a subclass of class A. So here another variable is created, C. Okay, display two is a method, sum is a method. Okay, so you observe here in the sum method, the values M plus N plus C are displaying. M plus N plus C is calculating. Where is, from where M and N are available? M and N are available in the super class. So the values are not declared here. You see, the values are not here. I tell you what is the case, what will happen if both contains the same things. Later I explain you. First you learn this basic thing. So M and N, M comma N are two variables which are available in the parent class. Okay, so those values you are adding M plus N plus C. Okay, this is class B. Class B is a derived class of class A, right? So now you see the demonstration. So now you are created objects for class A and class B. You have given the values of S1 dot M, S1 dot N. What is S1, sir? S1 is the super class reference variable. S1 is the super class reference variable.
S1 dot m equal to 10, S1 dot n equal to 20. Now you are accessing from here. So those values are supplied to the B also. So if you ask S1 dot display will print m and n values as 10 and 20. Then you are defining S2 dot m, S2 dot n, because as I already told you, this is nothing but acquiring the properties of base class. The properties of base class are m and n, which are now using by the base subclass object s2 dot m and s2 dot n. S2 dot c is its own variable. Whose variable? Second class, b class, where class b variable s c is. So but m and n are parent class variables. So now you are able to access them. So now if you access s2 dot display 1 and s2 dot display 2, now you see the result. Okay. Just I'll show you. If you want an example, I'll show you definitely. Inherit demo 1, demo, okay. So class, for example, class A, class B extends A, okay. So let us have some variables int m. Just I give some values, n 19, okay. I have given the values, void display, system dot out dot println, sum in class A, m plus n. Okay, so now I define class B. Class B, for example, contains another variable, let us say s. Okay, s is some 16. Okay, now let us void sum. The name of this method is sum. Okay, here what I will do is, here also I just print the sum to as m plus n plus s. Now you see, is it showing any error? No, because you have already written extends class B, extends A, means this class B is a derived class of class A. Now let us see how to access. Okay, so A, for example, A1, new A1. Similarly, A, B, B1, new B. What are these objects? We are now created the instances. Okay. So now if you invoke A1 dot display, what is the name of the method? Display. And in B, B1 dot, what is the name of the method? Sum. Okay. Now you get the okay, no problem. No? B4 is already. Okay, no problem. Now, because this were new. So now, what is the first one? Sum one is 31. 31 means that is the sum of
12 plus 19, m plus n is displayed for A4 class. This class doesn't. Okay, so I used m and n here also because this B4 is the child class of class A4. So that is the reason why I can use the variables m and n here without redefining. That is the meaning of redefining. Without redefining, I can use. If you want to get, you can get from this also. B1 dot display also you can write. B1 dot display also you can write, because you can directly access the members of your parent class. That is the meaning of inheritance. Getting the properties, acquiring the properties of parent class. That is the meaning of inheritance. Okay. This example you have seen, accessing superclass members from a subclass object. Okay, so just now I have shown you. So B1 is the subclass object. So using B1, I able to access the superclass members definitely. Okay, so now. So next, super keyword. Most important thing is super keyword. I can use this super keyword for the different purpose. Okay, so the creation and initialization of super class object is a prerequisite to the creation of subclass object. So when a subclass object is created, it creates the super class object. So using this superclass object, what can we do is we can call the superclass constructor. We can call the superclass constructor. You see this. Yes, you see this, this is employee class. This is employee class. Okay, so in this employee class, there are two variables, employee number and employee name. So this is the constructor of employee. So in this constructor, some values, employee number is 0, employee name is null. Okay, so something is printed. So next, employee have another constructor. Employee which takes employee number as an argument. So here the employee number is used to initialize the employee number. Okay. So next, employee name is unknown. This is one argument constructor. Constructor overloading also covers here. Please identify the concept also. So first one is the, this one is the default constructor. This one is a parameterized constructor. One argument is taking. Okay, next. So now you see here there are two, another constructor is created, which is taking two arguments, employee number as well as name. First one for number, second one for name. So the values are initialized. So this display method is there. This display method is used to display the employee number and name. So this is about employee class. Again, please remember or make a note. I'll keep it for you. Otherwise you already have the PBL app that there you can access. There is employee class which contains three different arguments. First one is the default argument, which takes no arguments. Directly the values are initialized inside the constructor definition. Employee number as 0 and employee name as null. First one. Second one is employee constructor is taking a single argument, that is employee number. So employee number is initialized here, name is not. Third one is it is taking both the parameters for employee number as well as for the name. Okay, two argument constructor. So display method is there. If I ask you display method, call display method, both the values of number, employee number and name will be displayed. So now there is a class called manager. Class manager extends employee, means
Employee class is the super class and manager is the subclass of employee. So now let us see how your super keyword is used here. So here a variable called department name is taken. Okay, our topic is not that. You have to concentrate on this. So while you are defining the subclass object as the statement is already mentioned, please see the statement previous slide. Yeah, see this. When a subclass object is created, the creation and initialization of superclass object is a prerequisite to the creation of subclass object. Means if you want to create the subclass object, the superclass object must be existed. Okay, when a subclass object is created, it creates the superclass object. It invokes the superclass constructor. So this is the main purpose of super keyword here. So whenever you are creating the subclass object, it uses the super keyword to invoke the superclass constructor so that if any attributes are needed, those attributes are also initialized. So finally followed by the creation of the subclass object. So the order is first superclass and then subclass like that. Okay. So initialization of its own you see this example here, you can understand. So this manager is the subclass constructor. This is taking how many arguments? 1, 2, 3. So employee number and employee name are there in the superclass constructor. And another extra parameter you are taking, that is the department name. So now if you want to initialize constructor, this subclass constructor, what you are doing is, in order to construct or in order to build this subclass object, subclass constructor, subclass object, you are just invoking the superclass keyword, superclass constructor, keyword to invoke the superclass constructor. So by passing employee number and employee name will be called here. In addition, only one value, that is department name, is the extra thing is required, so that whatever the values are supplied from the statement object construct statement, these two values are taking. First, the superclass object will be constructed and followed by the subclass constructor with number, name, and department name will be filled, means the initialized. Okay. So that is why this dot department name equal to department name is written. So what is the use of this superclass keyword? Superclass keyword is used to invoke the superclass constructor. Superclass constructor. Please remember, when subclass constructor is object is constructing, creating, the super keyword is used to invoke the values with super class. Okay, now you see this class is also having the same method, display. Now you have to understand the another reason why we are using super keyword. You see, I will tell you the concept later, but super keyword necessity you have to know. This employee class, this is employee class. In this employee class, what is the method there? Display method is there. Void display. The method is void display. You see, the same void display method is there in the subclass also. Void display is there in the superclass. Void display there in the subclass. So the methods in the superclass and subclass are having the name and method signature. Everything is same except body. So that concept is called overriding concept. I tell you later, method overriding. If the parent class and subclass methods having the same name, same written type and same signature, everything is same except body. So the methods are said to be overridden. Means whenever you invoke a method from the subclass object, the superclass version will be overridden. The superclass version will be overriding by subclass version. Means, that overriding concept is not here. Our concept is super. So when the super keyword is used here, when both the parent class and subclass are having the same method, in order to distinguish the subclass method and superclass method, if you want to invoke the superclass display method, you can use super keyword here. The first usage is to invoke the superclass constructor. The second usage is in order to invoke the superclass method, if the superclass method and subclass method are same, superclass method and subclass methods are same, so then you have to use the super keyword. Super dot display means it invokes the superclass parent class display method. This is another use. There is third use also. The third use is if the this subclass, suppose if the subclass is also having a variable which has same as the parent class. Suppose if x is there, int x is there in the parent class and subclass, definitely you can use super keyword to invoke the superclass variable, superclass instance variable, super dot x. Whenever you use x in the subclass, superclass x means, superclass x means that is the superclass parent class instance variable. So if both the superclass instance variable and the subclass instance variables are same, then you must use super keyword to refer or to access the superclass instance variable. Please remember, there are three uses of super keyword. First use is in order to invoke the super class constructor. This is the first use. This is the first use. The second use is whenever the methods in the subclass and superclass are same. See, this display, void display method is there in the employee class also. So now if you want to, you have the same method. So now if you want to get the access of the parent class display method, you have to use super dot display, because you have already, your subclass is already having this display method. This is about super keyword. Super keyword usage is this. Okay, using super to call super class constructors. First usage. This is the first usage. Super, if present, must always be the first statement. Sir, where I have to write the super keyword, super constructor, from where I have to invoke the super constructor, super class constructor? The answer is, it should be the first statement inside the subclass constructor definition. So this manager is the subclass constructor definition. In this you see the super class invocation, super class constructor invocation statement should be the first statement. Please remember, this should be the first statement, otherwise you get errors. Okay, so this should be the first statement. That is the meaning of this. It clearly tells you the order of invocation of constructors in a class hierarchy. First super class, and then subclass, and then next subclass. Constructors are invoked in the order of their derivation, however they are derived. For example, suppose if class A is initially constructed for defined first, and then class B for class A, and then class C for class A are derived. So the order of invocation of the constructors is first class A, and then B, and then C. The order of derivation is like that. Okay. So you see constructors order of invocation. This is an example. This is an example. This is class X, for example. This is the parent class. Class X. This is parent class constructor X, and next class Y extends X. So this is the subclass of X. So first subclass. This is the second sub. This is you see, this is multi-level inheritance. This is multi-level inheritance. Actually, this hierarchy is created like that. Class X, Y is child of class X, and then Z is child of class Y. So here, if you construct, if you call, if you create an instance object for Z, if you invoke Z, Z will invoke Y, Y will invoke X. You see? Okay. Next. Yeah, multi-level hierarchy example. You see, I already told you, employee, an example, employee class is the super class. Manager is a subclass of employee, means manager extend class manager extends employee. So means the manager is a subclass of employee. And next, another class you have defined, director, class director extends manager, means and then director is a subclass of manager. So the hierarchy is developed, implemented in the multi-level. You see, this is just a skeleton. You don't concentrate on the code, you just look at the way how the multi-level is created. Initially, employee extends object, means that is hidden in general, because object is the super class for any object. Okay, we need not write like this. Initially our base class is employee, and then manager, class manager is defined, extends employee means that manager is in a subclass of employee, and next class you have defined a class director, extends manager. So now director becomes the subclass of manager. So this is how the multi level inheritance is created: object class, employee class, manager class, and director class. This is object will accept the following in the order.
Okay, so this is inheritance part. So now I want to tell you one more thing, that is about method overloading means if two or more methods inside a class are having same name but they differ in return type, number of or order of arguments, anything argument, the methods are said to be overloaded. What does it mean? Very simple, sir, very simple. If I have a class, for example class A, I show you, I write here overload demo. You please observe here, understanding theoretical issues inside the practical thing, program writing is much important for writing the new program. Suppose class today, okay, so class today. So in this, what I want to do is, I want to have your calculator is the best example which exhibits overloading. If you give number, type some numbers, two number, example, two numbers. If you type, if you choose plus option, it gives you the two numbers result. Suppose you have given two floating point numbers. If you choose plus, it gives you the floating point result. Suppose if you take three integers, for example. If you use plus, it performs the addition of three integers. Okay, so like that, if the method, for example, void, I write you some example, void sum. Okay, here I just print a statement. I am addition method. A simple message I just displayed here, nothing else. Okay, I am writing another method should not same as the first method, it should not same. Now I am taking a different version. So in this case the number of arguments are different. So in this case what I am doing is, I am taking the same name, that is sum, but the number of arguments are differed. So integer sum, for example, x plus y. Okay, this is a two integer sum, for example. So next I am taking another method, which is also having the same name. But in this case, I am taking, for example, how many arguments? Three arguments. Okay. So in this case, what I have to do is, for example, return x plus y plus z. Okay, sir. Now you see the importance. Suppose if I have taken double sum, how methods are overloaded? Double, let us say x, double, let us say y, double, say z as the third variable. Okay, so return x plus y plus z. X plus y plus z. So how many methods are there? 1, 2, 3, 4 methods are there. Four methods with four different signatures. The only common thing is name. The name is same, but the remaining all are different. So this is called method overloading. Okay, if you want, I exhibit it. So what is the class name today? Okay. Today, T new. Today, I have created an object. So first one is T dot sum. If I invoke T dot sum for the first invocation, next T dot sum with two numbers, because that is the second method. You see, void sum of two arguments. Third is three arguments. It is a return value. There is a return value. For that, what I am doing is just I am taking a printing statement from there. Okay. Addition of three, for example, equal to so T dot sum of let us say three integers, 25 and 89. So three integers. And next, one more method I have written, addition of double value. Sum of 14.5, 25.89, 89.17. Let us say. Okay, how many versions we have, sir? Four versions. Please remember what to do, what not to do while you are implementing method overloading. Two methods should not have same name and same return type and same the other things, because you must practice each and everything. Then only you will be experienced. Otherwise, just it's like a demonstration only. There is no use unless you practice all these things. You must be understand, digest these concepts by practicing only. Nothing else is required. No textbooks are required. If you can understand concept from my class, and if you can practice more than once with different versions, different varieties. You practice with different return values. You practice with different parameters. You practice by taking same. What happens if you see? Okay, let us execute this. Okay, first one result is hello, I am addition method. Second one is two integer sum is 53 because you have passed 15 and 38. Third one is addition of 3, 128, 14, 25, 89. Last one is three double values, 14.5, 25.89, 89.17. Okay, this is what overloading. So the conclusion from this overloading is method overloading. Please make a note, method overloading is used to exhibit the static polymorphism. Static polymorphism, most important, static polymorphism. Static polymorphism method overloading is used to exhibit the static polymorphism. Okay, if you want, you can note this program. I'll scroll. If you want, you can. Make it fastly. Okay, I think everyone noted this. Okay, next concept is you also need to practice the corresponding questions, whatever the questions are given, hands-on assignment. Okay, you see this thing. Create a class called animal, which includes method like eat and sleep. Create a child class of animal named bird and override the parent class method. Add a new method, fly. Create an instance of, can we do this? Can we write this program? See, first here. Create a class named animal. Animal which includes eat and sleep. If necessary, I take some more classes also, but please practice all this. Animal. Okay, class. Animal. What is the class name? Animal. So what it asked? Class animal, which includes methods like eat and sleep. Void eat and void sleep. Write something. No problem. Eats vegetables and so something. Okay, sleep. System dot out dot printl and sleep for 10 hours. Okay, something. Okay, next. Next, another class. But the another class, create a child class of animal called bird. Bird. How to define it, sir? Extend animal. Animal what we have to do there, shared class of animal called bird, named bird, and override the parent class methods. So for this, what you need, overriding concept, method overriding. Okay, I'll show you. So inheritance means acquiring the existing properties. Overriding allows you, if suppose the subclass wants the same property as parent class, yes, you can do it. You can do it. Same methods can you have. Eat, for example, eat bird, suppose. You define its own method, same method. You see, void it is there, and void it is there in the bird also. So if parent and say child class are having the same method, with same name and same other things, means return type and everything, number of, order of, parameters, everything. Birds eat, for example, peanuts and grains, for example. Okay, so this is overriding. Then overriding occurs if both parent class and subclass are having the same versions of methods, and then we can call with the parent subclass method, for example, subclass object, the parent class version will be overridden. I show you. Void sleep. System.out.println. Birds sleep for 8 hours, let us say. Something. Okay. And one more thing mentioned, that is add a new method named fly. Void fly. So put something, some code. Birds can fly . Okay, so these are the three things you mentioned. So now coming to this main method class. What it asks, to create an instance of class animal and invoke sleep and eat and sleep methods. Okay, so for animal, you create a new animal. Okay, animal. Now call a.eat is one method, which invokes parent class animal eat method. a.sleep, which invokes parent class sleep method. Okay, similarly, create instance for bird, bb, new bird. Okay, so now call bb.eat, bb.sleep, and say, what is the last one? bb.fly. That's it. Okay, so now I think program is completed. That's it. Create instance of bird class, and invoke the eat, sleep, fly methods using this object. So even though there is the methods are same, we are not doing anything else. Just we are testing the functionalities. We have created an instance for superclass animal. We are calling the method from through the object AA. Similarly, I have created an instance for bird class. So I am testing the method eat, sleep, and fly with its own object, bb object, bb.eat, bb.sleep, bb.fly. Let us see. So what eats vegetables and fruits? First one, parent class. Eat method, parent class eat sleep method is displaying sleep for 10 hours. Okay, now the last three are with the subclass things. Subclass through subclass object, we have invoked eat, sleep, and fly. Birds eat peanut and grain. Birds sleep for 8 hours. Birds can fly. So this is the example given there. So I want to show you the actual method overriding, how it occurs. You know one thing, if the parent class, subclass can access the parent class property in general. So what I do is, I don't create a parent class method. So what I am doing is, I am created a subclass object, and I invoked the methods from the subclass object bb.eat, bb.sleep, bb.fly. Actually, bb.eat/sleep methods are there in the parent class also. Now you have to understand how overriding occurs.
If I call the eat and sleep methods, which are also there in the parent class, I am invoking them through the subclass object. So now the parent class version will be overridden. Overridden means not executed. They will be hidden. So let us see. Our parent class versions are displayed? No, only the subclass things will be displayed. Okay, let us change the program. For example, the capacity I am showing you without overriding means no sleep and eat methods are there in the subclass. Only eat and sleep methods are contained by the parent class. Okay, so the capacity of inheritance is the subclass can access the parent class versions, parent class members or properties without redefine. Now I can able to access. This is also possible. This is without overriding. This is just exhibiting the inheritance feature. Okay. Definitely. Now which version is invoking? Parent class version, because there is no eat method or sleep method in the subclass. When overriding occurs, when parent class and subclass both are having the same method and same name, with same return type and same everything, then only overriding occurs. Okay, you see. So now I remove again. I have written for the given example. Okay, sir.
These things you practice. So this is an example overriding. So when there is overriding, definitely one must understand there is a problem of method calls, method dispatching method calls. Okay, so in order to avoid that problem, we have a concept called dynamic method dispatch. Dynamic method dispatch is used to resolve the method overriding problem, that is the calls in the runtime. Means which version of method is invoking, whether it is a parent version, parent class method, or that is a subclass method. Suppose if that is a subclass, which particular subclass method, that thing we can implement through a wonderful concept called dynamic method dispatch. So the dynamic method dispatch is used to exhibit the runtime polymorphism. How? The simple thing is, we just need to create a superclass reference, dynamic method dispatch. We just need to create a superclass reference for implementing the dynamic method dispatch. Is a solution. Because the method invocations are made at runtime. Method invocations are resolved at runtime. For generally, the method, the invocation sequence is in general defined at the, they decided at the compile time. So with the help of this, the invocations can be changed during the runtime, because with the help of a concept called a superclass reference, superclass reference variable can be used to implement this particular concept. Okay. I will show you how it is implemented. So for this example, we can do it. For this example, for example, bird is there. I write another called, for example, suppose some rabbit or some rat. Okay, so this is also having void eat, void sleep, for example. Again, overriding occurs because same version class rat extends what? Animal. Okay, so this is also subclass of animal. There are two subclass for animal. One is bird, another is rat. System dot out dot println. Eat fruits and eggs, for example. Okay, similarly, system dot out dot println sleep for 4 hours. Okay, these are the two methods. So now, how dynamic method dispatch concept is exhibited means. Remove all these things. I will show you. What I have told you, you have to create the superclass reference. What is the superclass? Animal. Animal. For example, R is created. Animal R. Okay. R is, for example, new animal. So now R is holding what? R is currently holding the object of its own class. Suppose if you invoke eat method, r dot eat now, r dot eat, r dot sleep. So what does it mean? It first invokes the superclass eat method and superclass sleep method. So the order is predicted like this. And next, suppose if R parent class super reference variable, this is statement is nothing but R is a superclass reference variable. Superclass reference variable. Superclass reference. Please make a note. A superclass reference variable is used to hold the subclass object, but a subclass reference variable cannot hold the superclass reference variable. Please make a note. A superclass reference variable is used to hold the subclass object, but vice versa is not possible. So suppose if R equal to new bird means now the superclass reference variable is pointing what? Bird class object. Now if you write the same R dot eat, R dot what is that? Sleep. So now what does it mean? Now the subclass birds of eat and sleep methods are invoking. Next, this R is holding the another, that is the rat class object. So now that R is holding the superclass reference variable, R is now pointing the rat object. Now if you invoke R dot eat, similarly R dot sleep, so now these versions are rat class versions. Eat and sleep method will be invoke. This is exactly called the dynamic method dispatch. Let us execute this. You see, what is the first one? First one, again, I am repeating, a superclass reference is created. So the superclass reference is currently holding the, in this statement, superclass reference is currently holding the animal class object. So if you invoke eat and sleep methods, then animal class methods will be invoked. And next, bird class method will invoke, and then R is holding the rat class object. Rat, if you invoke so eat and sleep, rat class method versions will be invoked. Check it. Okay, sir. Initially, these two things, first two things are the parent class, and next, second bird class, and third, the last, that is rat class. Things are displayed. This is exactly called dynamic method dispatch. It is a solution for exhibiting the runtime polymorphism. Okay, here,
sir, Girish, sir.
2 minutes to solve the poll.
Hello, sir. Okay, ma. Let us discuss the questions. First question: which polymorphism behavior do you see in the below class? As I already mentioned to you, within the same class, all the methods are names are same, but they are different aspects. Return type, number of parameters. It is definitely method overloading, no doubt. Second question: which of this keyword can be used in a subclass to call the constructor of superclass? So majority are correct. Super is the keyword is used to invoke the subclass constructor. And next, what is the output of the following program? You see, final class A. Final, yesterday I mentioned you, final is used for three different purposes. One is to stop inheritance. If you write a class with the final keyword, so that class will not be allowed for subclasses, means no derived classes are possible from classes. So class A is defined with the final keyword. You cannot create inheritance, means no class B extends with A. It is a compile time error. You need not go further. You directly answer to this question. Easy. Fourth question: order of execution of constructors in Java, inheritance base to derived, however they created. And next, which method can be used in Java to perform garbage collection manually? Actually, garbage collection is automatic in Java. If still you want to perform our garbage collection manually, you can simply use a method called GC. GC, not garbage. Okay, GC method. That's it. Sir, finish, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Can we end the session, sir?
Yes, sir.